Hi, I'm Dr. Boz, and today's lesson on ketosis is all about that beginner who's looking for a good grocery list. This is another very common question I get from patients saying, what do I eat and how do I start? This post is strictly dedicated to that moment where you've cleaned out your cupboards, and if you read my book, I talk about you need to pause, just don't go shopping yet, pause. When patients transition to a ketogenic diet, there are so many things that go away. And the reason you pause is for this message right here. Let's start with the freezer section. Frozen vegetables are a good idea to have on hand, especially at the beginning of a ketogenic diet. The kind of vegetables that I recommend, broccoli, cauliflower, frozen peppers work really well. Frozen onions work okay, but I recommend the dried ones. Spinach and kale. There's some recipes out there that are filled with cream. They do taste good. I've learned that just having them on hand was the step one at saving me from falling off the wagon and saying, oh, forget it, I don't have it in the fridge. Next, I go down the aisle to get some fresh foods that actually get eaten. I have dozens of stories where patients would spend over $100 in groceries for foods they would never eat because it's just too strong of a change from what they'd been eating already. To protect you from that, I recommend you get a big head of cabbage. You don't have to eat it right away. Just put it in the fridge and one day you're gonna thank me. You can keep it there for like 2 months and it's still pretty good. The next thing is to buy a huge bag of spinach. Maybe don't do that the first week. I'll tell you why in a minute. And finally, buy some avocados. When it comes to the head of cabbage, this is the foods that my family and I transitioned to after we wore out our welcome with frozen vegetables. It turns out that a fresh head of cabbage not only lasts a long time in the fridge, so it will rescue you when you haven't planned ahead, but it has a really good crunch to it, and it really satisfied my craving for wanting fresh flavors or a fresh taste. Secondly, you could chop up that cabbage for 3 or 4 cups of cabbage, put some real butter and garlic over it, and put it in under a broiler. It only takes about 4 or 5 minutes to take it from a pretty crunchy vegetable to a nice golden brown under the broiler, maybe 8 minutes if you wanted a little more brown. It had a really nice flavor to it. My whole family ate it, and it, again, was quick, easy, and spoilage-proof. The next thing that I worked towards was after I had exhausted all different ways of how to make frozen vegetables taste good, I turned to spinach. It turns out my go-to entree when eating out was actually off of the appetizers menu, and it was a spinach dip. For so long, I had messed up this equation because there were hidden carbs and things that I didn't appreciate that I was really nervous about eating out. In the spinach dip was cream cheese and spinach, and instead of chips, I had them bring me celery sticks. And that's what I ate for the whole meal. It was incredible, actually. And that began to awaken my taste buds to like spinach a little bit more. After I got a little more used to eating spinach, I found a really great recipe for cream spinach. And this is where the really big bag of spinach comes from. Again, I like foods that you can make and you can use as leftovers. So this really big bag of spinach, like the kind at Costco, I mean, it's like as big as my whole body. You could put in a pot and steam it down, and you use cream cheese, sour cream, butter, garlic. It makes for the best cream spinach, and the leftovers taste good hot or cold. I found that having spinach as part of my diet, there's just so many nutrients that are in the spinach, and when you make it with those high cream, high fat sauces, it keeps you keto while getting the kind of nutrients that I think are a little harder to get. The next one on that list was avocados. And avocados and I have this love-hate relationship. I love a good fresh avocado. I will eat it right out of the skin with a little salt. But where I live, it's not uncommon to open up avocado and realize it was a good idea last week. So I've found this trick to be helpful when I'm using avocados, is that if I open it up and it's starting to get brown, I will scoop it out and put it in a Ziploc bag and put it in the freezer. When I freeze an avocado, I have used that high fatty food, when frozen, you can mix with some heavy whipping cream or some coconut cream, pour in a little stevia, and then some sort of flavor, whether that's peanut butter powder or cacao powder, chocolate powder, not the kind that you make hot chocolate out of, the actual cacao powder, and maybe some nuts, and it makes for a really good ice cream in the evening. I grew up on a farm where we had ice cream from something called the Swan's Man for 2 decades. And this habit of having something sweet at night, it's probably taken me a year and a half to break that. And when I get really stressed, it's totally what I want to do. It makes me think of the safety of the farm and being a child again. So in order to get past the ice cream craving, I've learned if I have this kind of slightly brown avocado in the freezer and I mix some cream with it, I can make one serving size. It doesn't turn into a whole week of being off ketosis or a bad idea, but it's just enough to satisfy my craving, and I think it tastes really good. So the next thing I have a list of is, if you're like me, processed carbohydrates for the chapters of our lives that we had been using them came with many flavors, and I didn't have to season things because it was kind of already built into most of the things we ate. But when going to a ketogenic diet, first of all, it took me like 2 months to get this right because so many of the sauces that I was using from a can or a jar had too many carbs in it. So I had to learn how to make my own. Secondly, I had a whole bunch of spices in the cupboard, and I think some of them were like from my wedding 15 years, 20 years ago, and I had never used them. So they were terrible. They were really old. So I threw all those out, and I decided to fill my cupboard with the flavors that I could get my palate to try. So let me read you the list of the spices that I think belong in a ketogenic cupboard, just because they are a lot easier to use than some of the others. And they include rosemary, ginger, I like the stuff that's in the paste, basil. I think buying a basil plant and keeping the plant alive while you use the leaves is the best answer. It really is the most forgiving for not preparing well, which is a recurring theme for cooking in me. Oregano, Italian seasoning, Cajun seasoning, black pepper, and pink salt. It was about 3 weeks into ketosis when I woke up out of my sleep with a terrible, terrible muscle cramp in my leg. Even though I was worried about trying to keep up with magnesium, I clearly had fallen below what I needed to be and was cramping up really badly. I used the salt baths that I talk about in another post to get my magnesium up, and that was great as long as I stayed with it. But it wasn't until I added that pink Himalayan salt or some sea salt, which does have magnesium in it, that I find I am always staying on top of it. I haven't ever gone back to that terrible cramping phase that I was at the beginning. So I recommend that. I think patients suffer from this low magnesium problem more than they know. And I feel like I harp on it all the time, but it is really important to take care of that. Some of the other little tricks that I found were lemon juice and lime juice can make almost anything taste better. Again, you can't cook with them at the beginning, but if you add them to cooking at the end, it really does add good flavor. Pili nuts, if you haven't tried those, they're really high fat nut from the Philippines. Macadamia nuts were good. Chia seeds, almond butter, and then almonds. Some other things that ended up on my shelf that I think are super important. One of them is olives in oil. There's a very specific olive salad that's in oil called muffuletta. And when you get to like the second or third week and you're so sick and tired of eggs, add a scoop of this to your eggs and it does make all the difference. The other thing that you find in my fridge that wasn't there very often was dill pickles. There's some that are naughty that have sugar in them, so be sure to read the labels and pick the ones with low carbs. But I find dill pickles in the house are really a big deal. That salt replacement is easy to do with a dill pickle and not adding too many carbs to your day. You can't have a ketogenic diet without some of these others, like sour cream, cream cheese, heavy whipping cream, eggs. My mayonnaise is made from avocado oil. I really like that. I make all of my patients try sardines. Don't say no until you've tried them. They are really high in those omega-3 fatty acids. They are super high in calcium. I really don't let them say no until they've tried them. I look for the ones without heads on them, and it seems to help them get over that barrier. But truly a great food that if you haven't tried it, please don't say no until you've had a few bites. The other thing, I'm from the upper Midwest, and you can go to any gas station and find something called liverwurst in our area, or it's called Braunschweiger. And this is liver pate. Very good for you, really high fat pate meat that's made from liver. I take one part cream cheese and two parts liver, mix it together, throw in some bacon on the outside, and we use it as appetizers. My family really likes that. Again, it's a food that wouldn't be found in your cupboard before a ketogenic diet, but I found that it's a very big success for those who can last on a ketogenic diet. We're gonna end this post with a little bit about fats, and I don't go into this a lot because it gets really sciencey, but this is how I keep it simple for my patients and even my family. You have three kinds of fats that are found in nature. You have saturated fats, and if you want to think of what baby boomers were told not to eat, that's kind of the saturated fat. They are lard, butter, and even coconut oil is a saturated fat. They're the most chemically stable. They're also hard at room temperature, and they're the most anti-inflammatory. Your monounsaturated fats are things like your avocado oil, your olive oil, macadamia oil, hazelnuts oil, and then your polyunsaturated fats really come down to your omega-6 and omega-3s. You'll see a lot out there about the ratios of that. The ever so popular omega-3 fatty acids, which are known to come from oily fish, they are very good for you. It is very important to get that in your system, and working on that ratio is an awesome idea, but I find patients get super overwhelmed if I go into that too early in ketosis. What they struggle with is that fat is good in the first place. There's so much of their mind and their hearts that believe this is the enemy, they shouldn't be touching fats, it's bad for me. But just getting them to like the foods with fat in it is where I keep the focus for almost the first year. So I tell patients to choose their fats based on their tastes. And some people have a really tough time with their gut getting used to absorbing that much fat. They can have a lot of loose stools early in a ketosis diet. This is really important to tell your doctor. It's something I take very seriously when a ketogenic patient shows up with chronic or explosive diarrhea. There's usually something going on in their small intestine that hasn't been discovered. In fact, I often find those small bowel problems when I put them on a ketogenic diet. So be aware of that. If you end up with diarrhea because you add these fats back and you think, oh, I just can't do it, it's not built for my body, don't say that. Tell your doctor. I hope this helps you. That time when you've emptied out the cupboards and you need to figure out what to buy, that's very confusing to patients. Take the list that's in this post, copy it, print it off, and walk to the grocery store with it. Be mindful as you go shopping. Don't spend $200 on stuff you don't like. Change your palate over time. If you want to learn more about this ketogenic diet, you can check out the book I wrote, Any Way You Can. It's on Amazon or Audible. And I'll be signing off for this time. I'm Dr. Boz. Until next time, thanks for checking in.